traditionally getting really high horsepower and reliability out of a Subaru four-cylinder engine has been somewhat challenging. And we're here with Leigh from Deshele Performance Engines to talk about what goes into a reliable Subaru engine when you're punching out perhaps north of 600 kilowatts. So for a start, Leigh, can we talk about some of the known issues with the Subaru engines? And particularly, I know they're very prone for bearing issues, particularly the big end bearing. That seems to be a common problem with them. What is the reason behind that, and why do people have so much trouble keeping them together?
Mate, I think it's probably down to maybe the bearing size, the oil pump, which now we can upgrade. We run higher pressure. We actually will modify the oil galleries in the block to feed the mains with the ones that do lack oil. I think that and setting up the clearances, definitely. We have got a couple of bearing mods that we do, which has dramatically helped.
Now, just to go back for those who maybe aren't aware of what we're talking about, the narrow bearing. So this is an issue with the Subaru engine design. It's a horizontally opposed boxer four-cylinder, and it is a very short engine front to rear. So if you look at a crankshaft, there's not a lot of material for the big end journal. So this is what we're talking about. The bearing is physically much narrower than a typical inline four?
Yep, it is, definitely.
Okay, so therefore the issue is the bearing can't do such a good job of supporting the load when we start running higher power?
Yep, higher power, and also with RPM I started to really notice that also had a dramatic effect on the bearings, so yeah.
All right, so the narrow bearing, that's one issue, but you sort of also talked around some of the other areas there that that sort of go hand in hand. It's not a one-size-fits-all fix. There's a few elements to it. I mean, most people would be aware, particularly on a racetrack where you're starting to get high lateral G-force, the factory sump can be a problem, and then you're not actually getting oil to the oil pump. So are the solutions for that, or is the factory sump up to task?
Look, it is up to task. If you're drag racing, roll racing, it's fine. If you are going around the circuit, it does definitely become a problem, but mainly under braking. Yeah, definitely, they see that.
And for those, again, who maybe aren't joining the dots here, if the oil pump can't pick up oil and suddenly it gets a lung full of air, it's pumping that air through, and all of a sudden we get metal-to-metal contact between the crankshaft and the bearing, and that's game over. So let's now talk about the oil pump, which is that next sort of element in the chain there. So what are the problems there with the factory oil pump that you're trying to resolve?
Look, mainly supplying enough oil, because the block does grow a lot. A lot of people that do build the motor tend to set the clearances up too loose on the mains. That is one of the main critical points that people go wrong. We actually tighten them up, and when they get hot, they expand. We go a bigger oil pump for more flow, probably running a good viscosity oil. And it seems to definitely eliminate, if you do have pressure and you don't pick up problems, you will eliminate that by tightening those things.
The factory oil pumps, though, no problems with the EJ in terms of the pump actually breaking, which we see with a lot of factory pumps?
It's very, very rare. I hardly ever see it. I think in my whole time of building engines, I've only probably ever seen two break, and they've been high kilometres, you know.
Okay, so that pump's there to increase the physical volume of oil, and by increasing the volume of oil, obviously the viscosity plays into that as well, but that's going to help improve the oil pressure. Yep. Just the aspect you just mentioned there with the block growing and the clearances. So quite often, if we look at factory clearances for a production engine and we're taking that engine and maybe we're going to double the power, it's a reasonably common trend to sort of build the engine on the looser side of the factory tolerance, or maybe even slightly outside the factory tolerance, with the fact that the crankshaft is going to flex and we want to stay away from metal-to-metal contact. Yep. So you're saying that that's not the way we want to go with an EJ?
Nah, definitely not. With such a short crankshaft, I don't think you get the whip or the flex in it like you would if it was, say, a six-cylinder or something a lot longer.
Okay, so I think that would be a common modification for those who are coming into the EJ engine with no previous experience in an area that's where potentially they are going wrong.
They tend to run sort of, I guess, like you look at old-school V8 type theories where one inch per journal, 1,000 per every inch of journal, but with these, yes, on the big ends, but on the mains, no. Definitely tighter. You got to pull them up, like back to factory, and they're a lot more successful with that.
Now, the other element there is that the EJ series engine, or any boxer engine for that matter, you know, physically it's trying to sort of tear itself apart when you're making high power. And I mean, I've seen my fair share of these engines and pieces where there's really obvious signs of significant fretting between the two halves of the crankcase. And that fretting is basically where we know that we're getting relative movement. So everything's flexing and significantly more than you'd maybe think. So how much of an issue is that, and are there solutions for that?
Look, yes, it does happen. We have made our own case stud kit, which has worked very, very well. We've seen when the boost comes on, oil pressure drop off with factory case bolts when the cases start to pull apart. When we put our, we put a new stud kit in, and it's obviously a lot higher tensile, it does solve that problem. The fretting you will get a little bit of still, because it's just basically a design in the engine, but our case stud kit has dramatically helped hold oil pressure at high power.
And when you say that, that oil pressure is dropping off at high power levels, so I'm guessing here that it's actually moving the block apart enough that it's just creating an internal leak?
Correct, it is, yeah. It's pulling the mains apart.
Now, of course, when you're dealing with an alloy block, when you go to a much stronger stud material or go to a stud from a bolt, something that you can get a lot more clamping force, the knock-on effect of that is you can end up, and almost certainly will end up, distorting the main bearing tunnel.
Yep.
So I assume here line honing is an absolute essential?
Yes, definitely, for sure. It's a must. You won't be able to get the clearances right without it.
Now, I'm interested in your take on this, because I've actually just had a conversation with one of our members on our forum, and whereby what they've done is basically taken a set of ARP studs, and the machine shop has basically under-torqued them compared to ARP specification in order to not get the distortion. And I know that this is a reasonably common move. I've seen this in the Honda world as well.
Yep.
Certainly, from my perspective, I don't see that that's a good solution. If I'm going to use an ARP stud, I want to use the manufacturer's torque.
Yep.
So is that worth doing in any way, shape or form in your opinion?
Not with them, because I have actually Rockwell tested their studs, and unless you do get close to what they recommend, you're not going to have the clamp load. Once it gets hot and things settle, they will be loose and you'll go backwards. So I would recommend, if you can and you don't pull threads out of blocks and things like that, and if that is not an issue, definitely stick to their recommended specs if you can.
Glad we cleared that up. I mean, from my perspective, if I'm using a part from a manufacturer, it makes sense that I'm going to use their recommendation. Now, another element I wanted to talk about with the EJ series engines is getting them to spool turbochargers. And this is, again, I've tuned a lot of four-cylinder engines, EJ, FA, and obviously every inline four-cylinder that's popular from Japan. And if we take a 2-litre, let's say a 4G63, and we compare that to a EJ20, and we put the same turbo on them, maybe something reasonably large, generally, all things being equal, we're going to see that EJ will spool quite a lot later.
Mm-hmm.
Now, is this an element of the engine's physical design, or is this due to the exhaust manifold design, being that generally that has to be longer on an EJ?
Definitely. I think it comes down to the exhaust heat. With a longer manifold, it's obviously not going to be as hot by the time it probably gets to the turbocharger, so you may be losing there. Filling those pipes up, and then always on a Subaru, you always have very long, you know, intercooler piping when you've got a front mount. So those things combined, I think, probably working in against you in that regard.
All right, so we've got a bit of detail now on the background of the engine and some of those problems and how to overcome them. I'm interested in diving a little bit into the car that you've got here behind you. So this is your drag car, and from my, if my memory serves correct, you said it'd run 880, 161 mile an hour?
Yes, that's correct.
So that's pretty quick for a Subaru. Obviously, there's faster out there in the world, but it's no slouch.
Yep.
Can you talk to us, first of all, about the engine combination you're using with this?
Sure. So it's an EJ25 block, fully closed deck, 40mm head stud conversion. We actually run a 2-litre, 75mm stroke crank. We put a longer rod to help the harmonics, which has done that significantly, like actually better than what I thought. The engine has gone to 10.3 with a steel rod quite a number of times now, which has surprised me, and it's still going, and it's got very good oil pressure, and everything's, the head sealing is perfect. It is really holding its own. It's surprising.
10.3 is definitely no joke. Yep. And for those who maybe aren't fully up to speed with all of the different Subaru engine combinations, that 2.5 block with the 2-litre crank, what's the capacity coming out to?
2.3, 4-litre, basically, yeah.
So it's gone 10.3 or whatever you just mentioned there in terms of maximum RPM. Yep. What do you try and shift it at typically?
I try to shift around 9.5 maximum, but sometimes I get carried away. As we all do.
Can you talk to us about the turbo combination you've got on the engine as well?
Yeah, so it's a Precision 7675 with a single entry 0.94 housing on it. It's currently on about 45 pounds of boost. And we're estimating it would be about 650 kilowatt at the wheels on a mainline chassis.
So you haven't tuned it at that power level on a dyno?
We have with the converter. It only shows about 500, but it's definitely making more.
All right, we'll talk about the transmission because that's an interesting aspect in a moment. But before we move on from the turbo, you've got a reasonably unique position for that turbo. And is this about trying to minimise the runner length, which we were just talking about?
Yeah, definitely. Shorten the intercooler piping up and, just be a little bit different, I suppose, from other people. So, yeah. And but mainly, yeah, definitely shorten the pipes up a fraction. So.
Okay, so we'll move on to the transmission because particularly with the GC8, that was the sort of Achilles heel of that chassis was the factory transmission.
Yep.
Obviously, there's aftermarket sequentials, there's gear sets for the factory box, and a lot of people go to the 6-speed as well, which is, in its own right, a pretty strong combination.
Yep.
You've gone quite a different route with this, with an automatic. So yep. Can you talk to us about your reasoning behind that?
Sure. So when we started playing around with the car, went in the drag racing route, like, of things. So, and just that was the way it went. And I thought the most reliable way to go for drag racing and to get the best times was to stick with a Subaru automatic gearbox. So we found one from an SVX and we used that as our base to start with. And just modified it and got it quite good. So, yeah.
What I've seen with a lot of people that have gone down the factory auto route is that there's definitely some advantages there in terms of sort of not upsetting the car and the traction, particularly during the shift. Generally, it's a little bit easier on the componentry as well.
Yep.
With the initial hit getting off the line.
Yep.
But I also see a lot of people spend quite a few seasons kind of working through the inherent problems and finding the next weak point in the box. Is that the same situation you had?
Oh, definitely. There was actually times where I came close to giving up on it. And just stuck it out and it just happened to fluke a couple of things that we modified that took it to another level. We've played around the line pressure, like we're up at 260 PSI line pressure at the moment. And it's helped a lot as well with getting it more reliable, with having that extra clamp. Obviously the clutches, wider band, it's definitely been a learning curve for sure.
In terms of getting the car off the line, are you using anything like nitrous to spool the turbo? Because that sort of tends to become the next problem with a large turbo, small capacity engine with a torque converter.
Yeah, so we're using 75 shot to bring it up to it. We're leaving it around 5,000 with a trans brake, and it stays on. The nitrous stays on and to the end of first gear and turns off for the rest.
Yep. So once you're out of the end of first gear, basically the turbo's got sufficient boost to be, you know, able to sustain itself.
That's right, correct.
And in that regard, just with traction, etc., are you using a boost control strategy as you go down the strip, or is it all in and that's it?
No, it's just all in at the moment. And funny enough, it's actually starting to lift the front inside wheel off the ground in second gear. So we're just letting it have it. So whatever it'll take.
All right, look, great to find out a little bit more about the car there, Leigh, and appreciate your time talking us through the Subaru engine.
Yep.
And obviously you run your own engine building specialist workshop.
Yep.
If people want to find out a little bit more about you, where can they go to?
Just deshelleperformance.com, we'll have engine packages that we do online and what we kind of specialize in. Sometimes there's a few articles on there, what's happening.
Perfect. Thanks a lot for your time, Leigh.
No worries, Andre. Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.